Yesterday, we understood what they mean by saying that Brahma is four-faced. That is, the creation occurs in four stages of externalization, which takes place in the form of the appearance of a world. And his wife is called the Lady of World. She is called in Sanskrit Saraswati. You know, Brahma's wife is Saraswati. If you go to Kakshed, you will find a husband called Brahma, whose wife is Saraswati. In the scriptures also, it is the same. But here in the scriptures, the wife of this wonderful four-faced Brahma, you know where she lives? She does not live in his house. The Saraswati of Kakshed lives in her house. But in the scriptures, this Saraswati is not going to live on the earth. She is living in the four mouths of her husband. That is how the scriptures describe. It is described that there is a square-shaped house with openings towards the four sides. That is, the house has entrances and exits towards the four sides. And this lady lives in that house, coming and going through all the four entrances. And they are his mouths. And she walks on his tongues. See, poor fellow. We will understand what it is. When we utter a word, what does it contain? It contains air coming out and the second one, sound. There are two items of utterance. First, let us understand with ourselves, then we can understand with Brahma. When we utter out, we utter air. It is exhalation. Then we utter sound also. And this is uttered only through the fourth phase. Because the fourth stage of our utterance is vocal language sentence. That is what we have seen. Then, before that, Saraswati exists as only language sentence, no vocal. We have seen the four stages of the sentence yesterday. So, in the other opening, she has no sound or air. In the third stage of utterance, she has only sentence without language, which is called concept. So, first this sentence comes to our mind as concept. Then we translate it mentally into our known language. Then we speak it out. And in the previous stage, she exists only as the I am of the creator. So, there is only Creator and Brahma, two in one. This stage can be compared with your consciousness before the concept comes to your mind. You feel like speaking. Then that feeling separates. Before that, there is no feeling coming out. But the feeling is only one with you. That does not mean you are existing, but feeling is also existing in you. The whole world is existing in you as you. See, take some water in a glass and some sugar in a paper. Now the two are existing. Place the sugar in water. Now also the two are existing but closely. Wait for some time. Only water exists. No sugar. That does not mean sugar is not existing. But sugar is existing dissolved in water. Similarly here, his wife is existing dissolved in himself. This is one aspect about the creator. And then in the fourth stage, when the sound and air comes out, the third word enters into it. That is the language. The language comes out as an expression. Language is not the air you speak out or the sound you produce, but it exists in your mind. Language is something mental, though it is vocally uttered. So she comes out with language. And then the next form also comes out, that is concept. The three put together come out. It is called the river. It is compared with the birth of a river. If you go and see actually the birthplace of a river, you will be disappointed. You do not find anything there except a few water coming out. You can never imagine that it grows into a river. If you begin to walk along with it, it becomes bigger and bigger, and finally you are afraid of getting into it. You want a boat. That is how a river comes out. Similarly, if we go through meditation to the birthplace of our world, you will find nothing except yourself. And from yourself, just a drop of yourself will be coming out. You will never suspect that it will become something different from you. How can a drop of yourself become something different from you? But always it happens so. The drop of yourself, which is your world, when it comes to your mind as a concept, it is already something different from yourself. It is objective to you. See the mystery of objectivity. And then all the details of the objectivity will be worked out. Previously, when the word was subjectively existing with you, you cannot examine it because you are that. When purely you are that, you cannot observe it. You can ask me why I am observing my body. It is because your body is not yourself, but it is your outcome. It is yours, but not yourself. You can observe anything which is yours, but you cannot observe yourself. You can observe your mind, because it is yours and not yourself. You can observe your intelligence, because it is yours and not yourself. So, in the first stage, it is the utterer himself. And all the other three stages come out as a river. That is why it is called the river of three flows. In Sanskrit it is called Tripathaka. Three means three. Patha means path. Ga means go. Tripathaka means that which goes in threefold path, in three streams. So, the Saraswati is described as a big holy river. And in the Rig Veda textbooks, you will find many mantras describing Saraswati. Many professors of history have mistaken to understand it as a geographical river. They had many discussions about the location of it. Some located it in the extreme north of India, some in the middle of India. But all those people could locate it only in their poor brains, as their own imagination. बिकॉज इट इज डिस्क्राइब्ड इन द ऋग्वेद दट थ्री पार्ट्स ऑफ द रिवर फ्लोस अंडरग्राउंड वेयरएज द फोर्थ पार्ट कम्स आउट एज द थ्री स्ट्रीम्स सो देर वर सम एक्सकवेशन्स आल्सो गोइंग ऑन to find out where this river is going under current. We hope someday they can find it under some stones. It flows under current in three stages, but becomes externalized only on the fourth stage. That means the vocal stage. Only when the word has become vocal, it comes out. All the other three stages are worked out under currentiness. And each of these three streams is described as having seven branches. That means, you know, the seven musical scales of the gamut. And the three stages of your voice. That is your normal voice, your lower voice, your higher voice. I think it is the same in every nation about music. Must be the division of voice must be like this. I don't know how it is in other nations, but in the Indian scriptures it is like this. The voice for musical purposes exists in three stages. It's called your normal voice and your subnormal voice or low tone and your supranormal voice or your high tone. So these three streams, each of these three streams comes into these three voices and each has seven branches and then it disappears into the ocean. That is how it is described. That means the ocean of sound in space, what we call the sound principle. So in according to Indian music, there are seven scales of musical sounds to each of these three tones. So in all 21. This is one aspect of the creator. Now apply these stages to the creation. You will understand how creation comes. And the law of correspondences tells you that your voice and your expression is also arranged in the same way. This is what is called the law of correspondences. The same tree is potentially existing in its seed. It is what is called the law of correspondence. Each living being is a seed of creation, and he has in him the epitome of all the creation. Just as you have a small photograph of the landscape in your room. That is what is called the law of correspondences. According to this law, you are making your own expression into your voice and utterance. According to the same stages of the creation through the creator, and according to the same divisions of everything. And then it is said that the drops of the river will get separated and they will become more and more minute and they will disappear into the vaporization of space. So some of the water goes into the ocean. That is the space. Some of the water ascends into small particles into air and becomes filtered and distilled to form clouds. What does that mean? Many of the sounds we utter, they go and join into the sound principle of space. So, like the sounds which mean nothing. But such sounds are sometimes produced. But some sounds carry yourself in the form of syllables, words and sentences. That is the small droplets. What do the syllables and words and sentences contain? They contain you as your concept and idea to be conveyed to others. What do they convey? They convey what is called knowledge. That is what is happening when two people are speaking. This is one description about the symbolism of the wife of Brahma. And she is therefore called the Lady of Wisdom. Her name is Saraswati. The word means a goddess who flows. That is a river goddess. And it makes you exist in the form of the syllables and words and sentences. And that part of yourself which you call your idea and concept exists in the sentence you utter. And it will be conveyed to others. And that is what is called knowledge. So, she is the lady who conveys knowledge through the living beings. See, she is described as seated in a milk-white lotus. So, to those who have studied the Indian scriptures, the milk-white lotus is a very sacred symbol. It is a symbol of wisdom and the joy that is felt through wisdom. A meditation of the milk-white lotus in mind purifies all the mental vehicles within a short period. If you are lucky, within the shortest period, which is 3 years, according to the masters. And also, the meditation of the white lotus opens up the gates in your personality so that your master makes a contact with you, because you cannot make a contact with your master. Master does not mean any name we think of, which means someone who knows us whom we do not know. If we think that we know our master, he is only our idea but not our master. So, the fact is, the master knows us, we never know who the master is. That is how it is described in the scripture. But a meditation of the white lotus, daily for a few minutes, opens up the gates of your personality that are working as barriers between you and your master in the form of your beliefs and your own valuable concepts which you are not ready to part with. So, it is a healing from self-conditioning that we get by meditating upon this white lotus. To make us meditate upon the white lotus while reading the scriptures, they have described the Lady of Wisdom sitting in a white lotus. Because when the author of the scriptures begins to describe, he describes the white lotus in all its detail and describes how the lady is singing in the midst of the lotus, during which you will be reading the poems and picturizing to your mind the meaning of the poems, during which period there is automatically a meditation. Otherwise, what happens if we are asked to meditate? We ask how to meditate. The answer is there is no answer. We have many advices from many pseudo masters about meditation, but any advice about meditation is a failure, because advice is objective and meditation is a subjective process. The only method to make you meditate is to send you into the subjective consciousness and making you aware of your subjective consciousness. That's why I always translate the word meditation in the following manner. That is subjective awareness. So when we become aware of our subjectivity, we are already in meditation, because the environment doesn't exist to us, because it has no effect upon us. Even though there are motor cars going on the street, they do not go to you. They do not exist to you. That's why an expert who sends you to meditation sometimes uses beautiful music, and he never uses the word meditation. And sometimes he takes you into poetry, describing the beauty of something like the white lotus, and you are already in meditation. If he then remarks, "See, you are in meditation," then you are immediately disturbed. That is what is called meditation. Therefore, the word meditation objects anyone to go into meditation. So the poet gives us a description of the white lotus, and she is sitting in the lotus with a face having a peculiar smile. Here a symbolism is used in the smile. It is called subjective smile. How can you smile subjective? You have to smile to yourself. Even then it is objective smile, because in your mind you are separate and your smile is separate. When you are smiling to yourself, two of you are existing. It is not subjective smile. But what we call meditation is subjective smile. It is symbolically described like this. Suppose there is one young fellow sitting. Let us call him Mr. Soleil. And his young wife is sitting beside him, and they are talking to each other. There is no one there except these two. See, his race go and reach her and then reflect only upon himself. Your earth is in darkness separate. This is what we call new moon. Therefore, her subjective smile is described as the new moon of the living beings. Fourth stage of the word. It means symbolically, Mr. Soleil means the I am in you. Moon means your mind. This young couple is sitting on the mountain in you, and he sends his light towards him. He smiles, and in reflection she smiles, and again he receives. The smile is only between the two. No third fellow knows it. That is how you have to smile to yourself. Of course, we can explain this symbolism, but we cannot convey the process one to the other unless we live together for a few weeks and have some time in the night or morning to make a practical experiment. But you might have just understood what it is. It is also described that this young couple had many conversations between them, many secrets whispered between them. Because there is no third person there, they had many, many confidential, private things talked. See, Mr. Sole says to his wife, sweet wife, that is, the I am in you says to your mind. He says, we are the two eternal entities. And see how these living beings are created by us. And some people worship me, and some people worship you, but both of them are liberated. So worship is of two types. One is those who worship the Mother God, and the other is those who worship the Father God, which means the two counter halves of the same. Counterparts of the same. Yes. So he says, some are worshipping you, some are worshipping me, and both of them are liberated. What does that mean? Some people look at the objective world and practice seeing God in others. Some people go into the I am of themselves and begin to practice the God existence in meditation. And again he says, those who worship you are born as ladies, and those who worship me are born as males. See, we have to decide. It means that those who worship the objectivity, they are receptive of the presence of God. Those who worship the subjectivity, they are the radiating centers of the presence of God. Receptive centers, some people are receptive centers, some people are called radiating centers. The receptive centers are called ladies, and radiative centers are called males. And he says, we get these people married in couples, and then they get liberated. That is how these two people sit down on top of a mountain and conduct these conversations. This is a part of the symbolism of the scriptures. So, this conversation is called subjective smile. The whole description is given because it is arranged in such a wonderful way that when someone who is an expert in the scriptures narrates us the meaning and significance and gives a proper type of recital of the whole passage, we go into the experience called subjective smile. It is only by following the description we can go into meditation. But no one can go into meditation if he closes his eyes and says to himself, I must meditate. Because what he meditates is only the idea, I must meditate. It is shouting like a dog in the house again and again, I must meditate, I must meditate, I must meditate. Then how can you meditate when the dog is shouting in the house? That is what we get if we try to propose to ourselves to meditate. It is a very artistic process, and the scriptures will give us a process to meditate. Our duty is only to just follow the process. That is to have an expert who is an adept, and then have a recital from him. It is enough if we just have the devotion to listen to it, just mentally tuned to him. The same thing happens if you attend a recital of the Old Testament or the New Testament, or the Indian scriptures or the Buddhistic scriptures. are the ancient Hebrew scriptures or Egyptian scriptures. It is enough if you do not find a difference between two scriptures. As long as you find a difference between any two scriptures, that means as long as you believe in the differences of religion, you are not yet mature to receive the meditation of the scriptures. So this is one aspect of Saraswati. It is also said in the description of Saraswati that she smiles silent. That is what they mean, the subjective smile. And she travels on a milk white bird, which is called in Sanskrit Hamso. The bird is called Hamso. It is translated as the bird Swan. It is a milk white bird. And this means only a peculiar poetic way of expressing what you know as soham. That is your respiration. So this goddess of word utterance and learning, she travels upon the bird of what you call respiration. And where to she is traveling? She is traveling, it is said, to her birthplace. Where is her birthplace? It is on the first 1/4 of Brahma's mouths. So she was born in the mouth of her husband. She is traveling there. What is there in it? The vocal language sentence is not there. And the language sentence is not there. The concept sentence is not there. But the original word which was with God and the word which was God, it is the birthplace. So it is poetically said, when she goes to her birthplace, she have to leave her physical belongings outside and go to him single. That means